do know more than 10 million people are physically abused per year. Well, it's true, and I decided that I wanted to help those people. Ever since I was little, I wanted to help people. That's why for your Make Your Mark, look right there, I decided to be a prison therapist, because I wanted to help the prisoners talk through their crimes and understand that what they did was wrong. That way, when they got out of the prison, that they would hopefully not commit any more crimes. However, that's not what I chose for my career. After we took the surveys on careercruising.com, my top two career clusters were human service and health science. Out of those results, my top three career choices were an abuse counselor, a social worker, and a funeral director. An abuse counselor helps a person cope and move on from the abuse that has happened to them. A social worker helps and protects kids in dangerous situations, and a funeral director helps arrange the funerals. The opportunity cost is the next best alternative that you are forced to give up. A social worker mainly works with kids, and I feel like that would be hard for me, and it would make me really depressed, so therefore that is my opportunity cost. An abuse counselor mainly works with adults and rarely works with kids, which would be easier for me. Now, before I could choose a career, I had to go to college. I lived on campus for all 4 years of my career, or my college years, and I went to Pittsburgh State University. I earned my master's degree in psychology. Now, being an abuse counselor, there are many bad and good things that come with the job. A few good things are, one, I get to work with adults. Working with adults, I feel like, would help me communicate with them more easier than working with kids. The second one is that I would get to help them out of dangerous situations. I would be able to help them cope with their situations and hopefully let them move on from that. The third one is that I get to help them succeed in their life after they have moved on from their abuse, because I think it would be fun to see them succeed. Now, some negative incentives about being an abuse counselor are, one, that the survivor may not want to talk about the abuse that is happening to them. So if they don't talk about it, then it'll be very hard for me to do my job and help them move on. The second one is that I cannot legally report the abuse that's happening to them, even if they want me to. So if the survivor is too scared to go to the rightful authorities, I can't do that for them. They have to do that on their own. And the third one is that the abuser could possibly find out, and not only I could be in danger, but the survivor could also be in danger. So if the survivor gets hurt because the abuser doesn't want them to talk, then they might be too scared to keep talking to me about it. Now, the abuser could also hurt me, and that would also make the survivor too scared to keep talking to me because they might not want me to get hurt. However, I don't mind being in danger as long as I'm helping somebody else. And this is one of my trade-offs. I'm trading safety for helping other people. To be an abuse counselor, I have to have many skills. I have to be trustworthy, because if they don't trust me, then they will not want to talk to me. The second one is that I have to be able to listen to them. If I don't listen to the abuse that's happening to them, then they won't want to keep talking to me, and I cannot find the right coping strategy to help them. Now, I work at this Sexual Assault Domestic Violence Center in Hutchinson, Kansas. I work full-time, and I get paid $31,300 a year. And when I divided that by 12, I got $2,608.33 per month. I work 8 to 10 hour days, and I could be doing many different things in a day. I could be in an office helping a survivor, or I could be in court for support in case that survivor has decided to report their abuser. I live near my work, and I share an apartment with my two roommates, Shaylee Kemp and Meredith Gray, and we live in a 3-bedroom, 1-bathroom apartment. We also split the rent, and we have no pets. This is another one of my trade-offs. I give up pets for an apartment with roommates that is close to my work. I drive to and from work. I drive a used 2006 Toyota Avalon XLS, and even though it's used and 11 years old, I was surprised that I only pay $117 per month for the car. I thought that I would be paying more. This is my third trade-off. I gave up a nicer, newer car for extra money to put in my savings and charity. On the student and parent estimates, my dad and I was either way off or decently close. For charity, we had both guessed that I would be paying $100, but in reality, I only paid $10. For gas and electric, I guessed that I would be paying $200, but in reality, my dad guessed $180, but since I split the bills with my roommates, I only pay $60. On my spreadsheet, you will see that the highest amount that I pay is to my taxes. That is $551.54. And on my pie graph, you will see that that is also 21.1% of my budget. You will also see on my spreadsheet that my lowest is to my toiletries. That is, and I pay $40. And on my pie graph, you will see that that is 1.5% of my budget. I use many articles to find out information about my career. One of them is a blog called How to Be a Certified Domestic Violence Counselor. This talks about the skills, the education, and the certifications you need to be a counselor. And the second one is Careers in Psychology. This one talks about what domestic violence is, what the counselors do, and why they are needed. I also use many websites to find out information about my career. My top five were Career Cruising, Career Zone, Career Insight, Statistics, and Human Services. The first three, Career Cruising, Career Zone, and Career Insight, all helped me find my careers, my skills, and my interests. Statistics helped me find out many things along with how many people were abused per year. Human Services helped me understand the impact of abuse on people. A wise man once said, "What defines us is how we rise after falling." I feel like this relates to most abusers and abuse victims and survivors, because they fall emotionally and mentally after they have been abused. This is why I chose to be an abuse counselor. I think it's important for them to rise up again after they have fallen. And yeah, does anybody have any questions?